Hello YouTubers, I am Professor Ajit Vedkur from Mumbai, India. This is part 2 of my e-lecture on adenomyosis. In this part, I will discuss the diagnosis and treatment of adenomyosis. First, I will discuss the clinical features of adenomyosis. A good gynecologist may suspect adenomyosis based on the clinical features and make a diagnosis using imaging modalities. But the final diagnosis usually has to wait until hysterectomy is performed. Today, we have understood the pathology of adenomyosis to the extent that a clinico-pathological correlation can be made. It is believed that the ectopic glandular tissue grows during the menstrual cycle and then advances, tries to slough. However, the tissue and the blood in the ectopic glands cannot escape because there is no drainage. This trapping of the blood and the tissue causes dyspareunia. It also irritates the surrounding myometrium, resulting in myohyperplasia. The associated congestion produces abnormal uterine bleeding. Adenomyosis is more frequently observed in 40 to 50 years age group multiparous women and in those who have had induced abortions. Severity of adenomyosis appears to correlate directly with the patient's age. In younger women, the disease is of mild degree. The classic presentation of adenomyosis is progressive dyspareunia beginning later in reproductive life, generally after the age of 35, and often associated with prolonged and heavy menses with passage of blood clots in a multiparous woman. A high degree of clinical suspicion is of paramount importance in diagnosis of this histopathological entity. Some women, that is around 50% of women, may not have any symptoms, whereas others will have severe debilitating symptoms. Triple dyspareunia, that is premenstrual, menstrual and characteristically post-menstrual dyspareunia, is present in 15 to 30% of cases. Some patients may have premenstrual staining, metrorrhagia or chronic pelvic pain. Dyspareunia, that is pain during sexual intercourse, is present only if it is associated with endometriosis. Remember, premenstrual, menstrual and post-menstrual, that is triple dyspareunia, is the key to diagnosis of adenomyosis. On per-vaginal examination, the uterus is smooth, uniformly bulky, but does not exceed 12 to 14 week size. If the per-vaginal examination is done during menses, the bulky uterus becomes soft, diffusely boggy and tender. This is called the characteristic Halban's sign. However, one must remember that exogenous estrogen administration may also produce similar effect. What is the effect of adenomyosis on reproduction? Although considered as a disease of multiparity, recent studies have shown that adenomyosis can exist in younger women and rarely even in adolescent girls. The precise role of adenomyosis in infertility remains controversial, and whether adenomyosis per se causes infertility is unknown. Adenomyosis probably affects fertility by causing altered contractility of myometrium, affects implantation, and causes poor placentation, resulting in poor reproductive outcome. Adenomyosis is a frequent finding in pregnancy, but is rarely associated with obstetric or surgical problems. Hayden suggested that adenomyosis of gravid uterus increase the risk of ruptured uterus, uterine atony and critical postpartum hemorrhage, but the risk is extremely small. Approximately 30 to 50% of adenomyotic foci respond to high serum levels of progesterone in pregnancy. However, it must be noted that pregnancy arrests only external endometriosis and not adenomyosis. This is probably because ectopic glands have estrogen receptors but not progesterone receptors. Differential diagnosis of adenomyosis is leiomyoma, pelvic endometriosis, chronic PID and endometrial carcinoma. Or sonography, a focal adenomyoma may be mistaken for a fibroid, and diffuse adenomyosis may be confused with myometrial hypertrophy, uterine contractions, or endometrial carcinoma. Adenomyosis, particularly adenomyoma, is often confused with leiomyoma. In adenomyosis, the uterus is uniformly enlarged and usually does not exceed 12 weeks in size, whereas the uterus with leiomyomas is asymmetrically enlarged and lobulated and can grow to any size. Leiomyomas do not cause menstrual or post-menstrual dysmenorrhea, which is a characteristic feature of adenomyosis. Transvaginal ultrasound, especially a power Doppler examination, can help differentiate between a leiomyoma and an adenomyoma. MRI, especially T2 weighted sagittal images, are helpful in differentiating adenomyosis from a leiomyoma. Now I will discuss the different methods of diagnosis of adenomyosis. Today, modern imaging techniques like transvaginal sonography and MRI have made it possible for the first time to make a non-invasive identification of adenomyosis. Various investigations that can be done to diagnose adenomyosis are hysterography, transvaginal sonography, MRI, myometrial biopsy, and CA125. Hysterosalpingography will show irregularity of the uterine contour with small outpouchings of the contrast material, findings that represent diffuse adenomyosis. Unfortunately, the sensitivity of this technique is too low for clinical practice. Currently, it is not recommended for diagnosis of adenomyosis. Transvaginal sonography is an effective procedure for the preoperative differentiation of adenomyoma from leiomyoma. Diagnostic criteria on transvaginal sonography are globular or bulky uterus, asymmetric thickening of myometrium, loss of clarity of endomyometrial interface, diffuse heterogeneous myometrial echogenicity, and myometrial cysts. Power color Doppler can be utilized to help distinguish between leiomyoma and adenomyoma. While larger leiomyomas tend to have peripheral feeding vessels which can be seen on Doppler, adenomyosis has either no vascular flow inside or there'll be vessels traveling the hypertrophic myometrium between cystic spaces. This is a transvaginal scan which shows asymmetrical thickening of the anterior wall of the uterus and loss of normal endomyometrial interface. Doppler shows increased vascularity in the anterior wall of the myometrium and not in the periphery, suggesting a diagnosis of adenomyosis. MRI is nowadays used to make a definitive diagnosis of adenomyosis. On MRI, a distinct anatomical structure can be identified. The inner myometrial layer underlying the endometrium is termed the endomyometrial junctional zone. Studies have shown that in a normal uterus, uterine peristaltic activity originates exclusively from the junctional zone, while the outer myometrium remains quiescent. A normal junctional zone is described as having a thickness of between 5 and 12 millimeters. The presence of a homogeneous junctional zone measuring greater than 12 millimeters in thickness with hemorrhagic high signal myometrial spots is highly predictive of histological adenomyosis. This is a T2 weighted sagittal image through the uterus which demonstrates thickened indistinct junctional zone arrows suggestive of diffuse adenomyosis. Myometrial biopsy can diagnose adenomyosis only if the biopsy contains ectopic glands and stroma. However, if it is positive, it puts the preoperative diagnosis on a more sure footing. It can be laparoscopically, hysteroscopically, or sonographically guided. The sensitivity of random needle biopsy is too low for clinical practice and is not used. Adenomyosis is associated with increased numbers of myometrial macrophages, elevated antiphospholipid autoantibodies, and CA125 levels in peripheral blood. CA125 as a diagnostic aid in adenomyosis is of limited value because levels may also be elevated in other conditions like leiomyomas, endometriosis, pelvic inflammatory disease, and pelvic malignancies. Recent studies have shown that CA125 antigens present on adenomyotic epithelial cells have different molecular mass from those present on eutrophic endometrium. The antibody binding site is, however, the same. If an antibody unique to adenomyosis could be isolated and purified, then a highly specific serum screening test could be developed for diagnosis of adenomyosis. And now I will discuss the treatment of adenomyosis. If at all a clinical diagnosis is made, treatment depends on age and symptoms of the patient and whether a pregnancy is desired. Various modalities of treatment are medical and surgical. Surgical treatment can be conservative or extirpative. For a young symptomatic patient, conservative treatment, that is observation and analgesia, is advocated. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like mefenamic acid are prescribed often. Another strategy to reduce both pain and bleeding is to reduce menstrual bleeding with cyclical progestins, oral contraceptive pills, or depo-medroxyprogesterone acetate injections every 3 months. Another option is to take oral contraceptive pills continuously for 9 weeks with a 1 week break to induce withdrawal bleeding and starting again. This way, the number of menstrual cycles can be reduced from 12 per year to 4 per year. The only drawback of depo provera is irregular, unpredictable menses, which are generally not acceptable to the patient, leading to a poor compliance. Decreasing the number of episodes of bleeding is thought to reduce the rate of growth of adenomyotic glands. Remember that adenomyosis is an estrogen-dependent condition, and menopause will be a natural cure. The chances of carcinomatous change in the ectopic glands is very remote, although a few cases have been reported in the literature. Another non-surgical option is to use progesterone-releasing intrauterine device Mirena. Several studies have shown that LNG intrauterine system is an effective and safe method in the short-term treatment of adenomyosis. Besides significant improvement of symptoms, a moderate but significant decrease in uterine vascularity and volume measured on transvaginal ultrasound has been reported. A major disadvantage of the device seems to be frequent, unpredictable intermenstrual bleeding and spotting, both during the first few months and after prolonged use. A danazol-loaded IUD is also currently under clinical trials in Japan. GnRH analogs are efficient in reducing the adenomyotic uterine size and may facilitate fertility. Leuprolide acetate 3.75 mg given intramuscularly every month or subcutaneous injection of 0.5 mg daily for 6 months has been used in patients who want to conceive later after stopping the treatment. For adenomyomata associated with infertility, GnRH agonist therapy may avoid the risk of rupture of uterus that may occur after adenomyomectomy pregnancy. GnRH agonist treatment before laparoscopic surgery greatly decreases surgical difficulties and blood loss in certain cases. Recurrence is common after discontinuation of GnRH agonist treatment. endometrial resection, including 2 to 3 millimeters of myometrium or roller ball endometrial ablation, has been attempted for treatment of superficial adenomyosis. It should be noted, however, that for patients with deeper adenomyosis, endometrial ablation is not successful. Myometrial excision, that is excision of well-defined lesion, can reduce symptoms and raise pregnancy rates significantly. It is acceptable to young women who want to preserve their reproductive capacity. Though the pregnancy rate of conservative surgery for diffuse adenomyosis is low, it still has a therapeutic value. Preoperative GnRH analogs are given to reduce vascularity. Uterine artery embolization done for patients with adenomyosis has shown to reduce the junctional zone thickness and produce ischemic changes, especially in the severe adenomyotic foci, and thus reduce symptoms. Success rates varying from 25 to 90% have been reported. The recurrence rate after uterine artery embolization treatment is not yet evaluated. Another option is MRI-guided focused ultrasound surgery for treatment of adenomyosis, which is currently under evaluation. In an older, symptomatic woman of perimenopausal age group who has completed her family, or when all other treatments have failed, hysterectomy as a final definitive treatment is advocated. Ovaries may or may not be conserved. The route of hysterectomy depends on the uterine size and associated uterine or adnexal pathology. Adenomyosis lends itself as an ideal indication for non-descent vaginal hysterectomy. If debulking becomes necessary for the bulky adenomyotic uterus, Lash technique is the ideal method. Remember, the principal diagnostic, therapeutic and definitive treatment of deep adenomyosis is still hysterectomy with or without ovarian conservation. New developments capable of revolutionizing therapy are the identification of endometrial stem cells and angiogenesis inhibitors. Expression of vascular endothelial growth factor, hypoxia-induced factor 1-alpha, and microvessel density in endometrial tissue in women with adenomyosis are presently under investigation. For further reading on this topic and other topics in obstetrics and gynecology, refer to following books written by me. Practical Obstetrics and Gynecology, Modern Obstetrics, Modern Gynecology, Clinical Cases in Obstetrics, Questions and Answers, Clinical Cases in Gynecology, Questions and Answers, and Pelvic Reconstructive Surgery.